wood and things. That also we have available at our technical support in the center. So we do that. So I just wanted to clear some position of maths laboratory that we have. Many people, like I was part of the CBSE manual, which is written for the maths laboratory for 9th and 10th grade.
Ma'am, excuse me. Ma'am, I've just started recording your session. So like, okay, with your permission, because if they can...
No problem. Yeah. So I don't know how many of you have seen that CBSE manual for grade 9 and grade 10 for maths laboratory. I was one of the writers in it. And the idea that we started in that manual was also to make mathematics interesting for students. So we had some collage, we had some activities, paper folding. But because it went into the system, it has become like an assessment. And when I now visit some schools with maths lab, I think students doesn't enjoy that much, because it's about maintaining a record book, assessment and things like that. Whereas our maths laboratory idea is more about somebody who has fear of mathematics, how to make him or her interested in math. And so it's more like enrichment. So that is the idea of maths lab that we have. And each activity in our maths lab, we have this one specialty, can be used with student and teacher, and as well as within student, you can have some part of that activity for primary, for middle school, for secondary, and for higher secondary. We will see that in an example. I am going to show you the same activity that I showed in the last presentation. I just want to complete it. But before that, just to talk about area, because last time, I don't know, you guys must be giving answers when I showed the square, but all of you, when you gave that answer, that 8 by 8 was 64, and there were tiny squares in it. So basically what we did was we calculated the area using some area. So this is something that I work with younger students, even school students, older students. And they, when you ask them that, how do you measure area? So they will say in centimeters. So we basically cannot measure the area in centimeters, because centimeter is the unit of a length. So you cannot measure area using length. The only thing you can measure using length is another length. So to measure area, you need to have some unit for area. And what people have done historically is that they have taken a square which is of 1 unit by 1 unit. And what they called is as 1 square unit. So there is no calculation involved in it as 1 multiplied by 1 is equal to 1. Instead, it is actually a convention that we decided to call a square which has side 1 by 1 as a 1 square unit. And then we can take that area and keep on measuring any area that we want to measure, any region. And similarly, volume is measured by volume. So all of you remember this problem from last time. And you know the area of this is 64. I can't see your responses. So I hope you can see that this is 8 by 8. And when we did...
Hello, excuse me, ma'am. They can write on the chat and then I can tell you their response, ma'am.
Okay. So if you can please write in the chat responses, questions, anything, Vini ma'am can tell me those. So you can see on the upper right left corner, there are red lines on which that 8 by 8 square is actually cut. So on the upper part, there are 2 triangles made, and on the bottom part, there are 2 quadrilaterals are made. And when you rearrange them, those 1, 2, 3, 4, you can also get a rectangle. So earlier we had a square, which is cut and made into a rectangle. Now what has happened? What is the area of this rectangle now?
65.
So earlier area was 64 and this area is 65. So is this possible? My first question, can we have an area, we cut them, and then we get a bigger area? If anybody thinks it's possible, can they also speak why it is possible? So nobody thinks it's possible. Everybody thinks it's impossible. Is that right?
It is possible. That is why it has happened.
Okay. Interesting. So I can't see your name, but whoever spoke, if this is possible, See, imagine the implication of this then. Okay, you can get, let's say, a silk sari from market and then cut it and reorganize it, and the area is increased. Or for that matter, you get a sheet of gold with some specific area. You cut it and rearrange it, and the gold is increased. If this is going to happen, then the world is wonderful, isn't it?
Mm-hmm. excuse me, ma'am. I'm from the bio background, so
Don't worry. I think your response actually gave us opportunity to see. Please, everybody, just make sure that you have to speak your mind. This is a place for learning. It's not the place to decide whether what is right or wrong. So all kinds of responses will only make us learn better. Okay.
Oh, okay, ma'am. So, like in the DNA structure, when DNA is packed inside the in the proteins, so it's actually like the area is modified.
Oh, okay.
When we actually open up the
cut DNA, and join it,
a long thing.
The DNA can do many things. DNA can also do mutations. DNA can also, which not non-living thing area cannot do. Yeah, I don't know about living
things
area.
So, in this example, is it possible that there is some kind of change happening in the plane in which it is placed?
Interesting. So, we will see that. So, we actually cut the paper, which is generally the square is a two-dimensional figure, but in our context, it is now three-dimensional. Like a shape, and we cut it and we arranged it. So something has happened which has made the area increase. And that point is absolutely right. So so what has happened? Let's see. So we saw that if we take a paper, let's plain A4 paper, if we just tear it up, and if I place it away, sometimes young children say that the area is increased. Because what they think that the space in between is also part of the boundary now. And something of that style has happened here. So when you cut this and when you rearrange it, can all of you can see this slide? The slope slide?
Yeah. Yes, ma'am. Yeah.
So if you calculate the slope, you actually don't need to calculate the slope. If in our maths laboratory, we have these pieces cut. So when you cut and try to arrange on each other, you will see that there will be a gap in between. And that gap is a parallelogram of the area, one square unit. So what we basically measured is the area 64 of these squares plus the space area in between, which is one square unit. That is what we calculated as 65 square unit. So this is interesting. And this gives us, so when we do it with students, it gives us opportunity to talk about different things of area. Like you raised some questions, no? What happens with the living thing area? What happens with the plane? So here we can talk about what happens with the slope. So this is how we think of a MATLAB activity. So at one point of level for young kids, it could be just fun to find out what happened. So they see, oh, there is a space inside and we actually measured space. But you can make it advanced by seeing that the slope is different. So when you will try to place this, the one piece on top of another, the lines will not align with each other. There will be gap. And this happens with some special kind of triangles. So let's see one more example. Here, something else is gonna happen. So this is 3x3. And I did these cuts, red lines, you can see. 3x3 square, so area is 9. And when I reorganize it, I get 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 10 area. So the one square unit parallelogram is here. This happens with 3x3. If you take 5x5 and do similar cuts, what you get is actually 8x3. So the 5x5, which is 25 square units, became 24 square units. So here one square unit area is gone. So you can also ask questions, can this happen? So unless while cutting, you don't miss any pieces, this shouldn't happen. So what happens here is the overlap. So when they actually work with concrete paper objects, this is, you all are pre-service teachers and you have been doing a lot of stuff, materials. You know, this making, this is not at all difficult. It just need a paper. And we have laminated this, so those won't get dirty when students handle it. So then they say that there is a overlap. So what is happening here? It's some special quality of some numbers. They're called Fibonacci numbers. So Fibonacci numbers are defined. The first two numbers are 1, 1. And the next number is obtained by adding previous two numbers. Most of you might know about this. So you start with 1, 1. So the next number is adding previous two. So that is 2. Next number is adding previous two, that is 1 plus 2. Next number is adding previous two, that is 2 plus 3, 5. So this is how you get Fibonacci numbers. And these numbers are, mathematicians are fascinated by these numbers because it just, the thing is that they're so simply formed, but they have so many different properties. And this missing area is one of the property that Fibonacci numbers has. So you take any numbers now. This language, can you see this language? Fn minus 1, Fn, Fn plus 1, which means Fibonacci number 1 previous, 1 and the next. So for example here, let's take the example 3, 5 and 8. Okay. So square of 5 is 25 and 8 3 is 24. Square of 8 is 64. And the cuts that we make so gives us triangle, a rectangle 13 by 5. Similarly, you will say 28 into 8 and 13 square. This would be 169 and this would be 168. So number three onwards, all triplets that you get have this property where the product of one before and one after is either one more or one less than the square of the middle number. And using this property, the missing area is. So what you can see in this puzzle is, unfortunately, you didn't get to play it, but playing is more fun with your hands. So you can see that there are all kinds of access points to the activity. The students can actually play, they can figure out, they can talk about it. Then they do some math, some students calculate slope, and then they learn this math and some of the properties of. So you can see the entry points are there for primary, middle school, secondary, higher secondary, everybody. So like this, we have many math activity. And Vini ma'am and we are all figuring out how we can collaborate further so that you will get access to those activities. But I am going to just stop with the math lab part here, and I'm going to move to teacher professional development part. If anybody has any question, they can ask. I just want to say that there are almost 70 to 80 more activities like this we have. And I can share you the entire booklet, which describes how to make those, how to play, what kinds of questions you can ask. We have that in Hindi and English and Marathi. But whenever the center opens, you should come and also play with it. Or whenever I can travel, I can bring those and show it to you. So that's that. If you have any questions, please.
Pramila, you have a question, so you can ask.
Ma'am, about this, the Fibonacci numbers, no? And you either get one greater or one lesser than the product, the square of the middle number.
Correct.
So is there some pattern where you know in these numbers it will be greater and in these particular numbers it will be smaller?
Yeah, there is alternate pattern. So basically it starts here. You can see the first triplet, that is 3, 5, 8. It is 25 and 24. So one is going to increase. Next is one is going to 5, 8, 13. It's going to decrease. So there is a way that we can write these numbers as in some algebraic form. If you're interested, I can also share that in to Vini ma'am. Kind of proof that tells us why this works. And another connected point is these cuts. Also to understand these cuts. They are same, but again, they are different for each figure. So you can see in what proportion they have been made. So 5 by 5, it is 2 and 3. Then here it's 1 and 2 red horizontal lines. And for 8 by 8, 5, it is 3 and 5. So you can see those sides, 3 and 5, are Fibonacci numbers. Okay. So 8 is a Fibonacci number. So you make a horizontal line for the Fibonacci number only, 3 and 5, horizontal line I'm talking about. Mm-hmm. Similarly, 1 and 2 here, and horizontal line, the 3 is Fibonacci number, 1 is Fibonacci number, 2 is Fibonacci number. Mm-hmm. And here again, 2, 3 and 5. Okay. So that way, yeah.
Okay, thank you, ma'am.
Thank you.
Shweta ma'am, I have a question here. When we are talking about mathematics laboratory, you can see that the schools, if you go to see, there is no mathematics laboratory. There is no science laboratory. Yeah. So what do you think, like, you know, could be the reason, and what activities the school can have if they have a maths laboratory on their own?
Yeah. So some schools approach us, and because they have space and maybe richer schools, they design a maths lab. And all the government school, for example, Atomic Energy School and CBSE School, actually, by regulation, they should have a maths lab. Because they have a maths lab manual and their examination marks are there, 20 marks are there for maths lab. But I don't know whether all CBSE school has, but all the KVs definitely have. Other schools, what we suggest, for lack of space, we suggest that why don't you do something that teachers can carry to the classroom and the student don't have to bring it to one room. So they create resources. We work with one teacher school and they create resources that they can carry and use it. So for example, for teaching fractions, we have different kinds of things that teachers can, other than the regular things that you have, like a circular sheet that can stick to the board or some cuttings. We also have something like fraction chart, which can use for comparing fractions. We also have something called addition nomogram, which can teach some shortcuts of addition in the sense to make them better in understanding place value. It's not really a shortcut, but it feels like for students it's shortcut. We have Gelosia multiplication boards or cards, bones. So for students, it feels like that they are doing something like game, but actually they are doing mathematics. So we do teacher and school specific sort of resource generation, and I'm sure we would like to do that, give that resource to even St. Xavier's teachers. So when they go to the school, they already have this with them.
Okay, ma'am, one more question I have now. You spoke about resource generation.
Yeah.
That is good. But you know, when we talk about mathematics laboratory as compared to a science laboratory, when we hear the word laboratory, it means that, you know, we have to do some experiments there, you know, and find out something new. So does that happen in the maths laboratory?
Yes, thank you very much for that question. So what I prefer to call is rediscovery, because discovery has already happened. So we have a set of puzzles. So this was a game, but then there are a set of things which are where students and teachers rediscover things. For example, Peake's theorem or... So where there are like a systematic things that they do, they take out readings and they actually come up with the theorem on their own by looking at the readings that they have taken based on the tool. So there is a pegboard or there is a geo board on which they do some activities. They take readings and they have to come up with a statement of theorem. And like that, we have some in those categories. And definitely, if we take a textbook, we can pick up some theorems. And we can design also activities in collaboration with teachers. That is why we have something called teacher fellowship. So where teachers can bring, this is a 9th standard textbook, and I want to teach these theorems in a discovery method. So then we help them how can they do that. But we don't have, we have some teachers' technical reports in which they have reported how they did this, but it's the teachers' work, yeah.
Ma'am, one more question I have. One is like, you know, what about the setup of a mathematics laboratory? Mm. Is it something different or how do you propose like it should be? Like when we saw the picture, it's like a resource room where...
Yeah.
So in the science laboratory, we have long tables and, you know, there are specific areas where students are sitting and doing the experiments and all. So is that like any design specific is there, ma'am?
Yes, I think setting does matter a lot. And we prefer like a small groups, round tables, lightweight furniture where students can move. We have written some specifications for what kind of size of room you need. Then hanging posters and things like that, where there should be a blackboard. For example, if you come to our maths lab, you will see blackboards starting from the ground. So literally from the ground, there is a blackboard because kids can write. Sit there and write, and there are up blackboards, so things like that.
Okay. Students, please ask some questions related to maths laboratory that's coming to your mind.
And if the questions come afterwards, please also send it to Vini ma'am. I can.
Yeah, but they can even
ask now. Yeah.
Ma'am, so can we come and see this maths lab at your place?
Yes, yes. So generally when there was no lockdown and all, every Wednesday is open for visit. Any day you can come, but just for our other conveniences, like we have seminars and stuff, we have kept Wednesdays for visit. You can come with like any number of students. You can come 4 or 5 people. You can come the whole group. Only thing is if you are coming as a bigger group, you need to inform us in advanced in the sense because all the spaces will be packed. So, and we also have integrated laboratory, which is science activities. So once people come for math laboratory, we make them sure, we make sure that they also go to integrated lab. There is gender and science exhibition, they see that also. So it's like a one whole day visit that you can do. And yeah. then you can come specialize if you want to learn all those 70 activities and make with your own hands and keep it as your resource. Then I think you can come for a couple more extra days. Some interest, few interested from you, not all of you have to come. All of you can come and see all the activities and get a feel of what it is. And depending on your interest, you can spend time more in one of the labs.
Okay, ma'am. So it's only through school and colleges we can come or?
Yes, yes. All school, colleges, only, I will give you an email at the end. You have to write to that email. That's all.
So separately, exactly. can we come?
You can come with your family also, with family your kids. Also. Yeah, yeah. Only thing is write and come. That is all. Because I, most of the times we travel. I also travel to different states. So if nobody's there, then yeah. So if you write.
Yes.
And it's a government center. So there is no Thank fees you. Or anything like that. It's completely free. All the materials, our posters are also freely available on internet that you can just print and hang it in your schools. You can also buy them. It's in subsidized price, 30 rupees at our center. But you can also print your own.
Okay.
Yeah.
So, ma'am, you can go to the next topic since we have only 15 minutes left.
Yeah. So, I'm going to talk about teacher professional development and I'm going to skip some of the things now. So, we do extensively teacher professional development, personally myself. My PhD is in teacher knowledge, in which I studied teachers. India and the USA. But we do teacher professional development in collaboration with Institute. We focus on content knowledge for teaching, noticing from our teaching, problem solving. With Xavier's, we have done constructivism sessions, we have done problem solving, and we have done content knowledge. And we have done one special thing that we haven't done for anybody. And I will come to that in a minute. We also work with government bodies because we are government. So it's sort of mandatory for us to collaborate with DIETs. I don't know whether you guys know what are DIETs, CRCs and BRCs, block research centers, cluster research centers. These are the places made by the government to help different levels of schools. A teacher fellowship where you can come and spend time with us for a week or for a month. And as I said, initially you can just take interest in learning different things, but then you can take up your own project and design either a new activity, set of activities, let's say for calculus or for trigonometry or for fraction, for ratios. I want to design 5-10 activities. You can do that and we will help you. It's a teacher fellowship is a paid position. So we pay you for actually doing some research, not only research, but developing some activities, things like that. So it's some 300 rupees or 400 rupees per day kind of a thing. And you can come for, I think at least 6 days or 4 days to 6 months. So that kind of, and you can apply for that. Mm-hmm. Interested people can write to me. I will explain how to apply. Then there are, I'm also involved in designing some courses with Somaya B.Ed. And there is a private body. I am a teacher, IAT. So I'm also part of their design and teacher. And Xavier's, I have not taught a course, but I've taken parts with Rashida ma'am sometimes. HPCSE is coming up with a course. I'm writing a book on few things which will be available soon. And some of the examples we'll see now what, which will be used for teacher education. So this is, this is already done. Can you see the screen about a 4-day workshop for teachers at Xavier's? So this was a lab class. So this is something that I don't know how many of you have heard about John Dewey, who came up first with this whole idea of activity-based learning in almost 120 years ago. And then he came up with this idea of laboratory class, which some schools in USA run, Chicago and all, which are very good. So what happens here is one teacher teaches the student and others sit behind. But But the planning for that lesson is done by all those teachers. So for example, you can see these are pre-service students from St. Xavier's. So they all 24 or 25 people and myself and Rashida and other teachers, we all made plans together for teaching. And then I taught to students. They saw anybody can teach, but I think people were just a little nervous. So I said, I will take. So I taught. And then after the teaching, we used to discuss and modify our plan. And this will go on for 5 days or 4 days kind of a thing. We did this, I think, 2 times. In HBCSC, I do this often. But with pre-service college, this was the only time done. And this is the time you see in the photo where where they can go and see students' work that they are doing. What they are doing, they can go and watch. So this was sort of a... In 2016, we did, and I think 17 we did. So this is something which is very close to our work of teaching. This is something that I've been pushing for. That I am saying that teaching is, people take teaching very granted. People think that anybody can be teacher, which I strongly oppose always. I say good teachers are taught. Really, pre-service college can actually, and that is why the which pre-service college you go does matter, because that is why, that is how you become the teacher. So you need training, and people generally think that everybody has a stakeholding in education and everybody wants to give comment. But teaching is not easy. You need to prepare. You need to be... So if being a good teacher is a difficult task, and if you're having a tough time, it is a good thing, because then only you will become a good teacher. Mm-hmm. So what I'm going to do now is, we do lots of things in our workshop. I'm just going to do one example. I have 2 examples, but maybe I'll do 1 example. And how do I talk to teachers? I'll just show you. So you have to participate now. So this is a scenario. So we work on scenario with teachers. So everything I do in my teacher professional development program, I insist it has to come from a classroom. No lecturing to teachers. It has to be a practice-based professional development. So you either bring video of a class, you bring textbook page, you bring student's notebook, but it has to be associated with teaching. Even the mathematics that you are talking about has to come as a practice-based artifact. So this is one from one of our student camps. We also do student camps. I didn't talk about it. So this was a question asked that 59 divided by 42 hai, and 359 divided by 342. These are 2 expressions. And if you have to put less than, greater than, or equal to, what sign you will put? So one student said he will put equal to sign. And when asked why, he said because 59 divided by 42 karenge, so you get 1 remainder 70. And 359 divided by 342 karenge, so you get 1 remainder by 70. So in both expressions, the answer is the same. 1 and remainder 70. And that is why they are equal. So now if you have a student like this, how would you respond to this student?
Okay, please respond fast.
Yeah. Or you can ask me also. If you have also a query, you can ask.
Shweta ma'am, I converted it into decimal point. So in the decimal point, there is a slight difference, like, no? So 9 divided by 42 is coming as 1.40.
Okay.
And when I do it as 359 divided by 342, it's coming at 1.049.
Correct.
So is there is a difference, huh?
So you will put which sign? Less than, greater than?
Divided by 42 would be greater than 359 divided by 342.
Okay. Has anybody else done like mini ma'am?
Yes ma'am, I also did the same thing.
Okay. So Vinnie ma'am is right. 59 divided by 42 is greater than 359 divided by 342. But what is happening here? When you read that student response, you think, yeah, iska bhi to sahi hai. 1 remainder 17, 1 remainder 17, so equal to. So what is happening here? So first of all, let's talk about what are our remainders. Okay. Is everybody with me? If somebody needs some extra time, 1 minute, I can go to back page. I just want to know whether everybody is with me.
I think they are with you.
Okay. Yes.
Yes, ma'am.
So first of all, whether remainders are whole number. For example, when I say that, when I see this 17 in the earlier example, can I call this number 17 as it is, or I have to always call it as remainder 17? Or like in the primary grades, they make everybody write remainder 17, R17, or in Marathi, Baki 17, Bache Hue 17. So they always make them write that. So what is this? Is remainder a whole number?
Yes, I think it is.
So can you call remainder just like 17? It's same as the other 17 number that we have in our number order.
No, it is not a whole number, because then, you know, you can continue the division, no, by putting the decimal point, and you can keep on continuing, no, ma'am?
Yeah. So everybody, so this is one thing as a teacher, we need to pay attention that none of the textbook ever talk about what remainder is.
Right.
They always talk about what is a dividend, divisor, quotient, etc., etc. But there is no attention paid to remainder. Whereas according to research, remainder is a very crucial topic to move on to fractions. Because remainder is not a whole number.
Yeah.
Remainder is, so this 17, the first 17 is actually 17 by 42. So it's one whole and 17 by 42. And in second, it is one whole and 17 by 342. And now it's very easy for you to see which one is greater.
Yeah.
Because 17 by 342 is going to be very small, whereas 17 by 42 is going to be greater than this. So even this one and one is same, the 17 by 42 is greater, and therefore this is going to be greater. So what we basically mean by one remainder 17, we write this in primary grades, is basically a mixed fraction, 1, 17 by 42. And 1, 17 by 342 in second. So this is what the meaning of remainder is. So like this, what we have in my book also, and our workshop also, what we have is scenarios like this for all the topics, milestone topics of middle grade, primary and secondary. It is going to cover that. We are going to see one more example. Does anyone have any question here?
So I want to share something that, you know, when students make a mistake in mathematics, they have this tendency to say that you are wrong, and we show the right answer. But we do not reflect and see why they have gone wrong and what could have gone in their minds, you know. And
that's why
students have this aversion to mathematics. Like, you know, it's always they are told that you're wrong, and it affects their morale. But this episode was so good, you know, and I wouldn't think of it till you have shown this. Like,
you are very right. And what has happened in school also, what happens is that when we teach, there is always fear as a teacher when I'm teaching. I used to teach in this nearby school for 3 years along with my job. And the principal used to come and stand there. And initially she used to advise me, how many students give wrong answer in your class? What is this? And for me, it was like, oh, wrong answer. It's exciting. Now I have some access to their thinking. This is all my research head is saying. And the principal is completely upset. Of course, she didn't have, because she was not paying me. She couldn't do anything with me like she could do with other teachers. So I had that freedom. I have to accept that. But then towards the end, when she saw the way students were speaking and saying things, they are still, that school is still collaborating with us now for almost 17 years. So we are working with their teachers. But initially, we taught there and they used to think that, ki kya kar rahe hai, bachche to galti kar rahe inke, aise unko. So bachche galti karna is resource for a teacher. Because now I know what I can do, what they are thinking. If they're just shaking heads and then exam mein nahi likh rahe, toh obvious hai, kyunki we didn't have access to what they were thinking.
Yes.
So errors, if you see errors as a teacher, it's our festival. But like Vini ma'am said, I think the question why is very important. If a child gives you answer, like she said, before giving a judgment, just find out why. So that is how we will find out the thinking. I'm going to do one more example and then I will stop. This one is quick, maybe not the next one. So this is a simple problem. What will be a real life problem for this?
a real life problem.
It's very simple. So I bought some yes, somebody was saying. No, I didn't ask for answer. This is another thing that we have been trained for. No answer, just word problem.
See, somebody started it correctly.
Yeah, we can use it for 7 minutes is how many seconds? So 1 minute
very nice.
Is 60 seconds.
Very nice. So 7 minutes is how many seconds? So you actually made a nice question. Okay, so everybody is on page till now. You can make lots of questions that something costs 60 rupees. How many of seven things will cost like that? Okay, so now I'll come to my main problems. Now look at this problem and make a real life problem. Take 1 minute here. In workshop, we give more time, but and you can talk to each other, but here I don't know how it's possible. Okay, I think because of time, Vini ma'am.
Yeah, no, you can take, because after this they have assignment. So students, can you just give us 5 minutes more of your this time today? Because I think...
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, okay, miss. You can go on.
So has anybody made any problem? Don't calculate the answer. Just tell me the problem for this. That's
ma'am,
something...
If I have a roti and I make... already there are four divisions of that roti.
Correct.
And in that four divisions, I have to again make 13 divisions. And then I have to divide it into two people.
13, you said?
Yeah.
So 3 1/4 means you have 3 full rotis.
3 full rotis and one quarter roti. Yeah.
So, pav chapati hai aapke paas aur 3 pure chapati hai. Aise hai. And then what you said, divide among?
Divide among two people. Actually, I calculated the mixed fraction and he said that is why.
Theek hai. But this is basically three whole. Mm-hmm. So if you have sabhi quarter chapatis hai, to 3 1/4 mein kitne aayenge pav chapati? Ek mein 4 aate hai. To 3 pure chapati mein already 12 aur 13. So that way 13 is correct. So 13 pav chapati hai aur wo do log mein baatne. Na? That is what. Anybody else has anything?
Very good.
Anybody else? Okay. Just a minute. I'll take this call. I don't know. Arun sir, I said tomorrow. Today I have a session with other teachers. Hello?
Yes.
So, you will make lots of examples like this, no? Like somebody, I don't know her name, she made 13 quarter pieces, quarter size ke 13 pieces and divide up between two people. Is that right?
Yes.
Everybody is with this?
Yes.
Okay. Now go to this problem and make this problem. So what would be a word problem for this?
Looks like the previous one was wrong.
Ma'am, this one is the right. Yeah.
both are same.
Both are same?
No, that was half.
So this multiplied by 2, this one, the first one, basically, into 2. So.
Okay.
This will be multiplied by 2.
This will be multiplied by or the previous one?
That the previous one will
previous one.
Previous one.
Okay.
Previous one.
One upon two.
So the word problem that we just made is the word problem for this. That there are 13 quarter pieces divided by 2. What would be word problem for this?
So we have 13 quarter pieces. Hmm. And how do we make 26 from them?
Yeah.
Because you know the answer, no? How do we, so you already gave the answer. So agar aapne the question that you just said, and if that is written as a text, we have 13 quarter pieces, how do we make 26 of those? The solution of that problem will be
double.
Many somebody would just say 13 plus 13,
Okay. How will you double it?
How do we make half of how do we make half of each piece? No, wait, something like that.
Because you can directly ask, like Mini Ma'am said, that how do we double it?
If we make half of each piece, how many pieces will we have?
So this stumbling that we all experience now, and I also experienced it, is the reason for this again the same. These topics are not handled in our curriculum anywhere. But as a teacher, we need to have the knowledge of these middle points, the missing points. Because then only we can talk about this in very confidently. So let's talk about what is the meaning in a very brief. I can take a one-day session on division by a fraction, like from how to teach, what materials to use, etc., etc. But I'm just going to give you a glimpse of how to understand division by a fraction. So the textbook handles the way most of you said it's other multiplication by its reciprocal. So 3 divided by 1 by 4 is basically 3 into 1 by 4, sort of. However, again, the meaning of this is situated back in the meanings of division. So when the division happens in primary grade, it has 2 meanings. One is share meaning and one is quotient meaning. So let's see an example. Don't fall for this terminology. It might look like a difficult terminology, but remember share and quotient, something like that. So let's take an example, 20 divided by 4. So I can ask 2 kinds of questions here. One question I asked, ki mere paas 20 cheeze hai. I have 20 things. I want to share them equally among 4 people. What's the problem? 20 divided by 4. Okay. Another problem that I can ask, still for the same problem. I have 20 things and I want to make packets of 4 things. How many packets can be formed? So both are actually 20 divided by 4. But the real life situations for both problems are different. For example, I'm asking there are 20 laddus. And if I have to give it to 4 people, how many each of them will get? Other question I'm asking, I'm making packets of 4 laddus. How many packets I can make in 20? So similarly, these 2 meanings also come ahead in the number system. So this is 20 divided by 4 division. We are talking in the whole number system. But when we come to fraction, the first meaning has disappeared. You cannot say ki 20 cheeze 20 divided by half karna hai. So you cannot say ki 20 cheeze leke aadhe logon mein baato. What does that mean? Aadha of what? And kahan se aadha insaan kahan se laenge? Yeah, whatever aadha. So the only meaning of division operation sustains when the number system changes is the latter one. And that is how many halves are there in 20. Jaise pehle pucha tha, how many fours are there in a 20. So similarly, when you go here, the meaning that remains with a fraction division is how many halves are there in 3 1 by 4. So 3 mein kitne halves hai? 6. And 1/4 mein kitne half hai? Aadha half hai. So the answer is 6.5. You can calculate and see.
Ma'am, can you just explain this last part?
Later? Yeah, I will do it again. So the meaning that remains in the rational number world for division, humne do meanings dekhe division ke. One is share, baatna. Another is group karna. Push is type ka. So I'm saying that the second meaning only remains in the fraction when it's the division is by a fraction. So the meaning is how many halves are there in 3 1 by 4. Another, I will make a similar problem to this. You have 3 rupees and 25 paisa in your hand. Okay. How many 50 paisa you have in with you? So you have 650. So 3 rupees mein 650 paisa ho gaya. And pav rupees mein half 60 paisa ho gaya. So basically you have 6.5. So aap isko calculate karke dekhiye. What do you get? 3 1 by 4 ko how did you convert it? 13 by 4.
6.5 it is.
13 by 4 multiplied by 2 karoge aap reciprocal.
Yeah, so it comes to 26 upon 4. 6 upon 4.
Which is 6 whole and 1 by
1 by 2.
So basically what we did that orally was how many halves are there in the first one. So that is the question.
Okay.
With the division of, that is the meaning of division of fraction. Yeah. Sorry. So the point is that all the operations, especially multiplication and division, these operation change their meanings when they go from whole number to set of non-whole numbers. Whole number matlab jo pure pure hai, and non-whole numbers matlab aadhe bhi jisme aate, like rationals, incomplete numbers bhi aate na usme. So then they change the meaning. In whole number, when you multiply two numbers, the answer is always bigger than those two numbers. Haan ki nahi? 2 multiplied by 3, answer is 6. It's bigger than 2, bigger than 3. Check with fractions. That's not true. In fractions, multiplication makes the number smaller and division makes the number larger. And we can also prove that when we have time. In very easy language, we can prove it why that happens. But aaj nahi karenge. But I'm saying that these all things about mathematics, about school mathematics, which are there in our work of teaching, that we can do in our teacher professional development. So this is one example. These are some of the responses that teachers created in one of my workshop, where they have figured out new ways of calculating. We are not going to talk about this. I think I'm going to stop here. Winnie ma'am is trying something to do as a collaboration, and I'm sure something will work out and we'll talk more.
Yes.
So thank you.
Ma'am, you stop screen sharing.
Yeah.
So it was like an intellectual treat, and you know, in the chat they have written it's a superb session, ma'am, and great thinking treat and very fun thought activities. And also we've got these messages from students, and I'm sure they all have enjoyed. And I would request Robinson now to propose the vote of thanks to ma'am.
Yes. Shweta ma'am, on behalf of our mathematics subject group, I'd like to thank you for your sharing. I never knew that maths could be so interesting. I always had inclination towards science, but now I think I can enjoy mathematics also. You know, I think we have a lot to learn from you. Apart from mathematics, the way of teaching also, your perspective towards teaching itself is totally different, you know, than what we experienced conventionally. So I would request Winnie ma'am to have, you know, few more sharing by you, you know, for us. But not only for mathematics, I think the rest of the college students also can benefit from ma'am's perspective of teaching, Shweta ma'am's first perspective. So thank you very much for your sharing, ma'am.
Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am, for coming. And I tried to call Dr. Subramanian, but again, I'm not getting him. So I'll continuously try, and then we'll see with what we can work out. Definitely, we need to have some collaboration with you, ma'am. Thank
you. He's good over email, Vinny, ma'am, so you can try.
Okay, so I'll send the email.
Yeah, I just want to say thank you. And teacher fellowships eligibility, I just saw a question. Yes. Anybody, prospective teacher as well as a person who is teacher.
I think,
and teacher educators also. Of course, for teacher educators, the stipend is a little higher. But it's not much. It's very minimal. It just covers your daily food ka paisa and some. It's maybe 600 per day or something. But you will also get to stay at our campus if you want to. The reason is then you can collaborate with other research scholars who are on campus in the evening and talk things.
And ma'am, during our vacation, I think that 1 month we can use for this, no?
Yes. And we do get other teacher educators during that same time. So that is also good that you...
Okay. So that
ma'am,
is
there a selection process for this teacher?
What we ask people is to write one paragraph proposal of what they will do. We generally avoid people who are just saying that I want to do something, because then it's too difficult. With some question in mind, or with some idea in mind, or something restlessness that I've tried to teach this and I found it difficult. Aise kuch hai. So we generally prefer those people. Then somebody saying ki I mujhe vacation chal raha hai, so I would like to come. So that would be matlab less preferable hoga. But if we have nobody, we will also take those people. But time jada jata hai training.
Ma'am, I had applied for science fellowship program last year, I think 2018. There was some selection process for that. And
That is a BESTEM fellowship you applied.
Yeah.
BESTEM fellowship.
I didn't get it.
Because it, not because of your eligibility, just because of first come, first basis. We only had, okay. So this is a Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru PMMT, some project money. We have also other projects in which we are teachers. So we host that. So there are only 30 BESTEM fellows allowed. So those 30, okay. You must have come late.
Ma'am, you were supposed to give some email ID, no?
Yeah. So I last time I showed it, it was on my screen. Can I say that again? My first name is Shweta, Shweta.
Writing it on the chat. Shweta.
I can also write it. I will write it.
Ma'am, you write it.
So that's my email ID. Write any questions that you have. I am good at responding on email, not on phone.
Okay, ma'am. This is a
thank
good
you.
Ma'am, can I ask one last question?
Yes, Anya, yes.
Ma'am, for the research programs, can you tell us any eligibility or any exams you
research,
have?
Research, yeah. Research is a little tougher. It's a MSc or master's you need. Then there will be entrance and then there will be interview. It's a very thorough screening. Once you get into research mentorship, it's a good thing. You get coursework, you get to study full time and you get scholarship for 5 years. I think per month it is 44,000 for first 2 years and then 55,000 for the next 3 years. So you can, this is just given for you to study and do research. So that's good.
Thank you, ma'am.
So hoping that you all will pursue something in mathematics also, students. With that hope, we will end our session today. Okay. Yes. And before you all leave, ma'am, you can leave. Please answer this poll that is coming up on your screen. It's just a feedback of today's session. Can you all see?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So can please answer it. Okay, so the poll is ended. These are the results which we have got. Okay, so thank you very much, students. See you in the next class. You all can leave the meeting.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am.
Most welcome.
Thank you, ma'am.